All right, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar, Heat Pumps, an emerging tool to support better health, cleaner air, and more affordable energy for all, presented by the Network for Public Health Law. My name is Daniel Wacker, and I'm the Program Development Associate here at the Network, and I'll be the host for today's webinar. Feel free to ask questions throughout today's webinar in the Q&A function down below, as well as using the chat to interact with each other, as well as the speakers. We do, however, ask that you put questions in the Q&A or else they might get lost within the chat function. And then with that, I'll pass it off to Jill Krieger, who is our Director of the Climate and Health Project here at the Network for Public Health Law. Jill's current work involves collaboration with governmental and community partners to develop and spread legal strategies to prevent and reduce the human health impacts of climate change and increase health and health equity. So, Jill, over to you to introduce the rest of the speakers.
Thanks very much, Daniel. Yes, as Daniel mentioned, I'm the Director of Climate and Health at the Network, and I'm really pleased to welcome you all to today's webinar. And I'll go ahead without any further ado and introduce our three presenters. First up, we'll have Eric Wilson. Eric is a strategic advisor to the U.S. Department of Energy's Deputy Assistant Secretary for Buildings and Industry. He co-led the development of the National Blueprint for Building Decarbonization and supported the launch of the Affordable Home Energy Shot. He is on detail from the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, where he previously led a team of researchers developing and applying REZSTOCK, an analysis tool for evaluating residential energy efficiency, electrification, and flexibility potential at local, regional, and national scales. Eric got his start in energy efficiency performing commercial building energy assessments across the state of Illinois and investigating air leakage and moisture issues for tribal housing authorities across the United States. Then we'll hear from Wael Kanj, a senior research associate at Rewiring America. Prior to joining the Rewiring America team, Wael received his Master of City and Regional Planning degree from Rutgers University, where he conducted quantitative research on the intersection between planning and public health, including how the COVID-19 pandemic impacted local food assistance programs, food security concerns during climate disasters, and how poor water infrastructure harms the Navajo Nation. Wael also spent a summer at the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority, expanding a home energy efficiency pilot program, and at Gale Studios, researching how free play can benefit kids, families, and communities. Previously, Wael was a data consultant for nonprofits and advocacy groups at Blue State and served on the board of directors of Counter Tools, a place-based public health nonprofit. Finally, our final presenter is Emily Levin, a senior policy advisor at Northeast States for Coordinated Air Use Management, or NESQAM, an association of state air quality agencies that catalyzes, guides, and supports state initiatives to improve air quality and address climate change. She leads NESQAM's Building Electrification Initiative, working with states to accelerate the transition to zero-emission buildings. Emily previously worked at VEIC for 15 years, where she designed and advised on building decarbonization and energy efficiency programs in multiple states, and helped launch the Tech Clean California Initiative to advance statewide adoption of heat pumps. Emily also serves on the Building Performance Association Board of Directors and Executive Committee. She has a Master of Environmental Management from Yale School of Environment and a BA from Amherst College. I trust you'll learn quite a bit from these presenters. They're a terrific panel, and we'll turn things over first to Eric.
Thank you, Jill. So I'm going to start us off by talking about what heat pumps are. I will then touch on some of their public health and equity impacts, and then finally share some of the research I've done related to the costs and benefits of heat pumps across the US housing stock. So what is a heat pump? Well, you may not be aware, but you probably already have a heat pump in your home. These are all heat pumps: central air conditioners, window AC units, refrigerators and freezers. These are all technically heat pumps, but when we say a heat pump, we usually mean a device that works in both directions and can move heat from in both directions. In other words, can provide both heating and cooling instead of just air conditioning. Now you might wonder how a heat pump could possibly work when it's freezing outside. Well, think of your freezer. Your freezer finds heat in a 0 degree Fahrenheit environment and moves it into your kitchen. So heat pumps for space heating do something very similar. How do these work? Well, you might say it's through the magic of phase change. We're all very familiar with how ice turns to liquid water, turns to steam. And there's actually a lot of hidden energy in these phase change transitions. Whereas water boils at 212 degrees Fahrenheit at sea level, the substances that are used in these heat pumps and air conditioners and refrigerators boil at much colder temperatures. One common refrigerant boils at minus 60 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's at atmospheric pressure. Now, a colleague recently shared with me that you can think of this phase change that's in steam. And really our whole modern society is built off of that, right? If you think about steam engines used for trains and for power plants, there's a lot of energy that we've captured and used in modern society that's in that phase change. And refrigerants are just doing that using a different substance. And what's special about heat pumps and air conditioners and refrigerators is that we're using a compressor and an expansion valve to precisely control the pressure at which those substances called refrigerants boil. So when you have a heat pump that uses the outdoor air as a heat source, we control the pressure of that refrigerant such that it boils at a temperature, say it's 0 degrees Fahrenheit outside, it's cold, but we've controlled the pressure so that refrigerant is boiling at that cold outdoor temperature. We then move that substance into a house or a building, and we then let it condense in order to release heat, just as you might take a glass of cold liquid and put it out in a hot and humid day and water condenses on it. Very similar, the substance then condenses and releases heat into that space. And with heat pumps, we can do this both using the outdoor air as a source for heat and for cooling as well. But we can also use the ground as a place where we can reject heat or absorb heat. So if that explanation's not working for you, I also like this explanation that uses gnomes. So you can think of a gnome pulls a little bit of heat from the outside cold air and dumps it into your house and snacks on some electricity to keep going. Maybe that's just because I have young kids. So there are heat pumps that can be used for space heating and air conditioning, heat pumps that can be used for water heating that take heat from the air surrounding the tank and put it into that hot water tank and heat it all the way up to 120, 140 degrees Fahrenheit. There are also heat pumps that can be used for clothes drying and such that you don't need a vent to the outside. Okay, now that we've got the basics out of the way, I'll talk about some of the public health and equity impacts that heat pumps could have. I was one of the lead authors of the National Blueprint for U.S. Building Sector Decarbonization that the U.S. Department of Energy released in April. And one of the things we did with this blueprint was to really focus on the people that are going to be impacted by this energy transition. And if building decarbonization is done right, there can be a lot of benefits that are delivered to people and communities. And I'm going to share some of the statistics that we came across in developing this blueprint, because I think they can be really powerful to get at some of the public health and equity impacts that that heat pumps in buildings can have. So first, if you compare the NOx pollution, NOx being a precursor to ozone, which has a lot of health impacts, fossil gas combustion in buildings actually emits twice as much NOx as pollution from gas-fired power plants. And this is despite buildings using one-third less gas compared to those electric power plants. How could this be possible? Well, power plants oftentimes have pollution scrubbers that can scrub out the NOx as they're releasing it, but buildings don't have things like pollution scrubbers. Now, the blueprint set out a goal to reduce on-site fossil combustion by 75% by 2050. We think this goal is ambitious, but still achievable. We quantified if this goal was achieved in conjunction with a electricity sector that is 100% clean electricity by 2050, that the avoided health impacts would total up to $50 billion per year from avoided PM2.5 and NOx pollution if this goal was achieved. And this was pretty simple calculation done using the EPA's COBRA tool. I encourage you to check it out if you're interested to get a value like this for your specific state. It's pretty easy to go in there and plug in 75% reduction for residential and commercial gas and oil usage and get a number that's specific to your state. So that's a pretty compelling number. One other statistic we came across was just the fact that pollutants have a different impact on health depending on whether they're emitted close to the ground level where most buildings are or elevated at the top of a smokestack, as you might get with a power plant or a factory. And there's a journal article here that that has this table of different marginal damage values, so a dollar per ton of the pollutant that is emitted. And for some of these pollutants, and there's different models in how you quantify these health impacts, but oftentimes you'll see that the value for emitted pollutants at the ground level is up to twice as large as the damage value for polluted up high. So that really shows that the impact, the stronger impact that pollution can have when it's emitted from our buildings. Finally, one other statistic that I found to be very impactful was the fact that people of color are exposed to 90% higher rates of ambient particulate matter from sources such as residential gas combustion and commercial cooking compared to white people. Now you can see that some of these other sources like industrial facilities and light duty gas vehicles emit more PM2.5, but the sources that have the highest disparities are residential gas combustion and commercial cooking. And that just shows how buildings can play a pretty key role in potentially addressing some of these historical inequities. And finally, I'll touch on some of the benefits of or distributions of costs and benefits for heat pumps. And this work was published in a journal article a few months ago called Heat Pumps for All, Distributions of the Costs and Benefits of Residential Air Source Heat Pumps in the United States. Now, despite all what I shared about the health impacts, this study was really focused on greenhouse gas emissions and not emissions of other pollutants. So we quantified the distributions of greenhouse gas emissions impacts, but we did not look at any other of those criteria pollutants. And then from a cost economic perspective, we didn't monetize any of those costs. We only looked at costs from a consumer point of view. In other words, impacts to energy bills, both for fuels as well as electricity, how those would change through adopting heat pumps, as well as the incremental cost of replacing, say, a furnace and air conditioner with a heat pump at the end of their lifetimes. So that said, we wanted to understand, well, what does the consumer, if there's all these benefits, what does the current consumer value proposition look like? So we did this by taking a lot of the different sources of variability that affect how today's heat pumps perform. And that includes both the performance of the equipment itself, as well as the quality of the housing stock that you're putting the equipment in, whether that's the level of insulation, air sealing, which climate it's going in, how occupants are behaving, as well as other housing characteristics. We also looked at sensitivities to different economic factors, as well as emissions from different scenarios about how the future electric grid might evolve. And we used a physics-based simulation of about 500,000 representative US homes to quantify what would happen through these different scenarios and the distributions of the costs and benefits were an outcome of this work. So the first finding I wanted to share with you today is focus on the lifetime greenhouse gas emission. Now, we looked across a wide range of different future scenarios about what might happen with the electric grid over the next 15 years, the lifetime of typical air source heat pump equipment. And we looked at these five different scenarios, ranging from a more pessimistic scenario to a more aggressive scenario that's in line with current administration's goals. And all these scenarios were based on modeling that was done before taking into account the impact of the Inflation Reduction Act and what that might have on the change of sources of renewable energy on the grid, for example. But what we found was across all five of these different scenarios that have different levels of aggressiveness of how quickly the electric grid is changing, we found that across all these scenarios, across every single US state, there would be lifetime greenhouse gas emissions reductions, or in other words, a benefit across all these different scenarios and different scenarios of heat pump performance. And you actually see larger benefits in colder northern states. So sometimes I hear people talk about, well, the grid in the state is still dirty. It doesn't make sense to do a heat pump or do home electrification yet. So we found that's actually not the case if you account for the trajectory of the grid going forward in time instead of using historical emissions rates. The next finding I wanted to share was related to the costs. In this work, we developed distributions of bill savings, the upfront cost of the equipment, and then consumer net present value. In other words, is that investment paying back for itself? Is it cash flow positive if financed, for example? And we found that, not too surprising, that the savings are strongly dependent on the efficiency of the air source heat pump that you're considering. And if you take a minimum efficiency heat pump, the kind of lowest efficiency equipment that is actually typically found in a lot of southern states and is commonly used in southern states where natural gas service isn't as prevalent, if you take that piece of equipment and put it into a home that's in a colder climate, you could have the bills go up. And you see those potential bill increases in orange here. And those are mitigated almost entirely by moving to more efficient equipment up to a high efficiency cold climate heat pump, or adding on envelope improvements as well. By building envelope, I mean insulation, air sealing, improving the thermal performance of the building. So many of these homes that have potential bill increases for the lower efficiency heat pumps are homes that use fossil gas, piped gas, as heating fuel currently, or homes that that don't have air conditioning. Because we're assuming that once you put in a heat pump, these homes now have air conditioning and now have this additional benefit in terms of resilience during heat waves and improved comfort and productivity. And but utility bills would go up if you now start using this for air conditioning. So you see that effect captured here in these distributions of bill savings. And then next we quantified the incremental upgrade cost. And we find that, you know, it really, if you're in a cold climate, it makes sense to invest in a cold climate heat pump and or envelope upgrades. Well, really necessary for heat pumps to make financial sense, especially in older housing stock in colder climates. But both of these investments, the colder climate, higher performance heat pumps, as well as the insulation and air sealing upgrades, they come at a higher cost to consumers. So despite the many benefits they have, there isn't a great consumer value proposition right now. So you could say that the consumer value proposition is misaligned with the current societal benefits that heat pumps and these building insulation upgrades could provide, whether that's in terms of climate, public health, or resilience. So in the paper, we discuss how policymakers could consider ways to address this misalignment. For example, the Inflation Reduction Act included tax credits and rebate programs for heat pumps, as well as building upgrades. Many states and local governments also have their own incentives to help address this misalignment. Policymakers could also invest in workforce training programs and support innovative business models that can help reduce the soft costs of installing heat pumps. Another thing to mention, in many states, electric utility rates, they're designed to discourage additional electricity use. And while that's been great from an energy efficiency perspective, It tends to overestimate the true societal cost to serve that new electricity load from devices like heat pumps and electric vehicles. So public utility commissions that regulate utility rate structures could also play a critical role, for example, requiring utilities to design rates that better reflect the societal benefits and costs of serving that new load. And then finally, while heat pumps can work great in all climates today, there could be additional investment in research, development, and demonstrations that unlock a new generation of heat pumps that ultimately cost less to make, cost less to install, and perform even better. And the US Department of Energy is working on that today by partnering with manufacturers on cold climate heat pump challenges, both for residential heat pumps as well as commercial building heat pumps. Finally, our third finding is that even if you look at air source heat pump performance today, without including any of these subsidies that I talked about, we found that they are cost effective in about 65 million US homes. Almost two thirds of homes, they're cost effective today without accounting for any of these subsidies. And looking at this distribution, this is mostly true in homes that currently use electric heat or use oil or propane heat, where they'll have a great net present value or payback. Whereas homes that use fossil gas, about two thirds of those homes we'll see currently have negative net present value for those homes. And we can look at how these are distributed across the country and looking at a median as well as the fifth and 95th percentiles, how these are distributed. And you can see that, you know, looking at the median, it's mostly colder climates where fossil gas is commonly used for heating, where the median household might have a less favorable payback currently without accounting for some of these other societal benefits. Now, what we see though is that in every pocket of the country, there are homes that can benefit today financially from installing a heat pump. And we've talked about the very clear climate and public health benefits, but being able to afford the upfront cost of installing that equipment is really a critical barrier that incentives, financing programs, and utility rate reform, things like that, could help to address. And with that, I will turn it over to Lyle Kanj to talk about our next segment.
Great. Thanks very much, Eric. Cool. Okay. Can everyone see my screen? I'm going to assume yes. Thank you, everyone very much for having me. My name is Wael Kanj. Again, I work at Rewiring America, which is an electrification nonprofit. And I'm going to be talking to you today about some work that we are doing to quantify the health benefits of residential building electrification broadly, as well as for heat pumps specifically. So the modeling and analysis I'm going to be talking about is sort of ongoing work for us that hasn't been published yet. And so I'll be sharing some numbers, but we're hoping to share sort of more formalized outputs and publications later in the summer. So just keep an eye out for those. So I'll give a little bit of intro and background on our work, both Rewind America and the analysis we're doing, as well as talk a little bit about how we did this modeling and some of our early preliminary results. So Rewind America was really founded in 2020 with the idea that to meet our carbon emission goals and our greenhouse gas emission goals, we have to decarbonize our entire economy, and that really begins with electrifying our households. So that's everything from what you can see here, stoves, vehicles, water heaters, including heat pumps as well. And really our founding principle is that, and something that really animates a lot of what we do, is that about 42% of our energy-related emissions come from decisions made around the kitchen table. So it's how we heat and cool our homes, how we heat our water, how we cook our food, dry our clothes, the kind of car that we drive. So when, you know, we talk to folks and they'd feel like a lot of action around the climate wasn't available to them or accessible to them. I think this is a really meaningful number for folks to wrap their heads around because it's deeply actionable. These are all things that we can make decisions around just in our day-to-day lives. So, you know, we've sort of talked about why going electric is so important. And if you're concerned about the climate crisis, you know, going electric is one of those really impactful actions that you can take. And just some more specific numbers in terms of how much greenhouse gas emissions in the US are driven just from fossil fuel combustion for the things that we're doing in our homes, with household vehicles also having a really big impact of about 17%. So, you know, Eric sort of touched on a lot of those benefits, but for many folks, for virtually everyone, improved efficiency. For many folks, you know, we're anticipating lower bills. And, you know, something we're going to talk about today a lot is improved air quality indoor and out. So just to sort of recap some of the different actions that sort of we talk, when we say going electric, we're talking about things like induction stoves, air source heat pumps and heat pump water heaters, which use similar technology to just warm different things, heat pump dryers, electric vehicles and solar panels, which I think most of the general public is more aware of. So a lot of the work that we do at Rewiring America is communicating the benefits of electrification to the general population, to households and consumers. And a lot of our work sort of focuses on the things that we've been talking about, like lower bills and lower greenhouse gas emissions. But in doing our work, we really felt like quantifying the health benefits of electrification could be an additional benefit that there wasn't enough attention focused on. And so that's where we wanted to focus our efforts in this analysis. And so quantifying the avoided health impacts and costs by electrifying residential buildings, making that analysis and those numbers sort of available to organizations and partners who are working on climate or who are working on health to really help us make the case for the benefits of electrification at the community level beyond the bill savings and the efficiency and emissions savings. So a lot of the existing work around the health benefits of electrification to date have focused on indoor air quality. So actually one of my colleagues, Taylor Grunewald at Rewiring America, was one of the lead authors on a study last year, which showed that approximately 13% of childhood asthma cases could be attributable to gas stove usage in the home. So it's very clear at this point that burning gas in our stoves in homes, especially if it's not very adequately vented, which most people don't, you know, use their vent enough to really rid all the pollutants from their homes, has a host of negative health impacts. And that's very important work. We wanted to expand our sort of scope to really look at outdoor air quality as well, because appliances like heat pump water heaters and heat pumps, you know, that are replacing furnaces and gas water heaters, those gas burning appliances and fuel burning appliances vent a lot of their pollutants to the outdoors. And so we want to capture that in our attribution here. And another sort of, I think, important reason in terms of our analysis was that while for many folks or for individual households, it's difficult for us as researchers to maybe get the specific conditions inside of homes in terms of folks' baseline health and the conditions of the house, but there is a lot of public available data around community health metrics and population health. And so by capturing outdoor air quality impacts, we're able to really make better estimates around the health impacts of some of these electrification actions. So to really understand how electrification impacts health, really wanted to break down the impacts of two sort of distinct things. One is burning fossil fuels in the home, and the other is burning fossil fuels in a power plant to actually generate electricity. And they both can impact health through slightly different mechanisms, but it's a pretty similar process. So on the top of the page, you know, a home burns fossil fuels in its space heating if it has a gas or oil furnace for water heating. Those appliances, Eric sort of alluded to this, they emit what we call criteria air pollutants, which is essentially air pollution, into the outside air when they vent. Criteria air pollutants, which we call CAPs, are things like sulfur dioxides, nitrogen oxides, primary PM2.5, which are very small, sort of microscopic air particles, which become concentrated in the air, and when they're breathed in by the general public, lead to health impacts. Everything from premature mortality, increased risk of stroke, asthma, acute myocardial infarctions, and a host of other negative health impacts. And sort of a similar thing happens at power plants, which are still burning fossil fuels. So, from the home's perspective, we'll use, some electricity for maybe space heating or water heating, since a lot of folks do use electricity to sort of heat their homes or even for cooling their homes with their AC. That energy is created at our power plant, which also will emit some air pollutants, which become concentrated in the air as it drifts from power plants to nearby homes and even homes. We've seen that air pollution from some plants can travel hundreds of miles away if it gets picked up from the wind and if it's, emitted very high in the air. So that also leads to health impacts. And so we need to consider both of these things when we did our analysis on what the sort of net impact was of electrification, because it's driving changes in both of these two processes. So I've started to talk a little bit about the analysis, and I'll give sort of a very brief overview of the work that we did, but I want to make sure we have enough time to sort of talk about some of our early results as well. So we first wanted to calculate what is the total health impacts associated with fossil fuel combustion. And Eric alluded to the COBRA tool, which is one tool that's available. There are other tools also available in terms of what we call like air pollution transport models that can help us convert from specific emissions coming from buildings and power plants, spatially distributed. We can put them into this model and get what the actual pollutant concentrations are across the entire country from specific emission locations. We can then use those concentrations and convert them to incremental health impacts using some health impact functions. So this is, again, something that COBRA uses, and we used very similar health impact functions using effect sizes from two papers to estimate what the prematurity mortality impacts and costs were from these emissions from buildings and power plants. So this gave us sort of an overall picture of what is the total, health impacts from national residential fossil fuel emissions and power plants, but it didn't really tell us what is it for an individual building or for if a given home wants to upgrade to a heat pump, what's the health impact from that action? And that's actually where we turn to Restock. And so Eric already talked about this a little bit, but this was really, having access to Restock and this data set that Eric and his team built was really the thing that made it possible for us to get more granular and really understand for a given building, what are the health impacts for doing an electrification upgrade, including a heat pump. And so we could use the information from Restock, which includes on the left a building level change in energy consumption. And because we know and we were able to calculate how many emissions come from different changes in energy use or just energy use of a given fossil fuel or of electricity, we're able to estimate for a given building who upgrades to a heat pump, what are the changes in the quantities of pollutants from that building upgrading or retrofitting it to install a heat pump. And then we can use those benefit, we used new benefit per ton factors, which we calculated specific to both residential fossil fuels and electricity across the whole country. Since, you know, a building in a very densely populated area, burning fossil fuels will have a different health impact than one burned by a building in a much more sparsely populated area, because the concentration of people and emissions are much higher in the first scenario. And so sort of the results of this process is that we can have, for a given building, what is the building level avoided premature mortality and costs for a range of different electrification and efficiency upgrades, like the ones included in RESTOC. So I'll talk a little bit about some of the early results from our analysis and some of the numbers that we're seeing. So when we quantify the actual health impacts, the two sort of main data points we were looking at are how many avoided premature deaths are we avoiding from reductions in outdoor air pollution because of building electrification. So when we remove that fossil fuel combustion and we shift a little bit to electricity, how many premature deaths are you avoiding? And then the monetary value associated with those deaths, which in this case, we're using the value of statistical life from the EPA, which is about 11.5 million as of 2024. So when we look at the total health impact number, it's essentially the number of premature avoided deaths premature deaths times that value of statistical life. And so what you're looking at here is the national average for different electrification and efficiency upgrades in terms of their annual health savings, in terms of avoided health costs. So these are a mix of actual upgrades that are modeled in RESTOC, as well as some that we modeled ourselves on top of RESTOC. But you can see for some of the biggest actions like heat pump, insulating your home, which is, you know, weatherizing it, air sealing, and installing a heat pump simultaneously, we're looking at least a couple hundred dollars in terms of avoided health costs. So health benefits from installing that heat pump and insulating the home. That's higher than things like a heat pump water heater or a heat pump dryer, which just use less energy. You need less energy to heat water in your home or to dry your clothes overall than you do just heating and cooling your home overall. And so that's why we see lower magnitudes of impacts for some of those smaller upgrades, but they also have net positive benefits. So this is really impactful. And we were really sort of excited about the possibility for this work once we saw how these numbers were turning out, because if you look at some of the national averages for how much homes would save on their bill savings, a lot of them are in similar sort of orders of magnitude as some of the health savings numbers. So it was really sort of encouraging to see that, I'd say maybe simultaneously encouraging and surprising to see just how much impact, you know, a single retrofit for a single home overall could have in terms of avoided health costs. So I'll dive a little bit more into the heat pump and insulation one here, because by using RESTOC, we're able to actually break down these results, not just for the nation overall, but for, what fuel was a home previously using to heat their home. What we can see is that actually not all fuels are sort of created equal. So homes that are heated with delivered fuel oil, when we upgrade them to a heat pump and insulate at the same time, actually have a higher sort of avoided health costs a higher health benefit from upgrading those homes, because fuel oil is so polluting and it emits so many of those criteria air pollutants. So when we're removing that from the home and putting in a heat pump, there's really a big positive health benefit. And then because our analysis incorporates electricity grid, you know, a lot of critics of or skeptics of electrification will say, well, you know, we burn fossil fuels in power plants. And so aren't I just shifting and now burning fossil fuels somewhere else? We did do similar analysis in terms of looking at what are the projected trends for how the grid's going to clean up over the next 15 years. And when we account for that, we can actually see that the increase in fossil fuel combustion in power plants to sort of power these electric appliances still does not outweigh the benefit of removing fossil fuels from the homes. And so this is just sort of an illustration to get to that positive impact from removing fossil fuels in the homes in terms of the overall health benefits. And so because we're using redstock, we're able to actually get these benefits at a very granular level and incorporate all these different factors that might impact how the health benefits would differ in different places throughout the country, including what's the baseline health in that area, what are the actual household characteristics. So in some places of the country, homes are bigger than in others. That's all being taken into account in our analysis, as well as how is electricity being generated? How do we project it will be generated over the next 15 years? And other things I mentioned, like the climate and population density. So just to sort of make this, I think, maybe more salient, I can dive into a little bit of a case study for a city in New Jersey, actually pretty close to where I am right now, which is Plainfield. It's a city of about 50,000 people and 16,000 households. It's sort of a bedroom community, suburb of New York City. And about 80% or so of the households heat their homes with natural gas. And it has a poverty rate about double the New Jersey average overall. And so our analysis, when we look at the average numbers for Plainfield, and the benefits of electrification there, actually take all of those different things into account. So we actually see in our preliminary results that the average health savings from a heat pump and insulation in Plainfield is actually maybe around double what it is for the country overall. And again, that reflects all those sort of unique aspects of homes and the population in Plainfield. And so, you know, we can have a number of about $600 per household, but when you look at that, that's an annual number over the course of, you know, an appliance's lifetime of about 15 years for a heat pump, that's actually closer to about $10,000. And if we were to electrify and insulate every household in Plainfield, now we're looking at something more like around $150 million for all 16,000 households in the city. And then we can go even more for the whole state. For New Jersey overall, electrifying, again, based on our preliminary results, on the order of billions of dollars in health impacts for a single state each year. And so if there's, you know, I think anything to leave folks with, it's that, and sort of what we're seeing from this analysis, it's that electrification is essential if we want to address the negative health impacts of burning fossil fuels. And so we're hopeful that as we continue to develop this analysis and sort of finalize our findings, we'll be creating what we think is a very powerful tool the different practitioners and advocates can use for really making the case for building electrification. So that's all I have. Thank you again for having me today. And feel free to reach out if you have any questions, and I'll pass it off to Emily now.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me join you. Can everybody hear me and see me okay? I'll assume so. Yes. Really appreciate the opportunity to be with you all today. I'm here from NESCOM, the Northeast States for Coordinated Air Use Management. We work with the air quality and climate agencies in the Northeast, providing technical policy and convening support. We also collaborate with states outside the region. And in particular, we have a buildings initiative, which I lead, which is working hard to advance zero emission buildings. So I'll just take a minute to kind of share a couple thoughts on why our states, from a state perspective, care a lot about heat pumps. And it's really the outdoor air pollution impacts. Air regulators, air quality agencies are charged with meeting the national ambient air quality standards, improving air quality, and fossil fuel combustion in buildings, as we've just learned, produces both greenhouse gases, climate pollution, and criteria air pollution, like NOx, fine particulate matter, and then NOx combines with sunlight to form ozone, all of which create a lot of health harms, premature birth, premature death, asthma, respiratory issues. So it's all of concern. And in our region, specifically in the Northeast region, Eric had shared some similar information nationally, but buildings, while producing less NOx pollution than transportation, that's our biggest sector for NOx pollution, building pollution, on-site pollution from fossil fuel combustion is actually larger than industrial emissions and larger than power plants. So it's something that our states are really concerned about and are paying attention to and looking for new strategies to address. And again, I would emphasize, we're really focused on the outdoor air pollution effects. A lot of these pollutants, pollution sources combust to the outdoors. States' authority is really to regulate outdoor air pollution to a greater extent than indoor air pollution. And I would again note that the largest contributors to that pollution are heating and hot water. So, you know, we care about stoves too, but the big ticket items in terms of outdoor air pollution are space heaters, HVAC systems, and water heaters. And that all contributes to ozone non-attainment in the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic. So you can see that there are regions in the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic region that we work with that do not attain the national ambient air quality standards for ozone and are therefore required to come up with strategies to address that pollution. And as they're making progress in other sectors and still either not attaining these standards or barely attaining them, they're definitely paying attention to pollution from buildings, which from the perspective of an air regulator is kind of uncontrolled at this point, unlike the power plants, which have scrubbers on them and other controls of various sorts. The building pollution is completely uncontrolled right now. So it's definitely something to take a look at. So that's all a little bit of background for why NESCOM and our member states care about this issue. And now I get to switch to the positive of kind of the message of, well, given what Eric and Wala have shared about heat pumps, how they work, their impacts, their costs and health effects, there's growing momentum for heat pumps. I think you've probably all heard of that momentum, and I have the fun role of being the positive person who gets to tell you about some of that momentum that's happening and how much that's going to drive the market for heat pumps. So this is kind of what I'm going to cover briefly at a high level. The state of the market, there's unprecedented federal funding, there's a lot going on at the state level, and then we'll conclude with a little bit of a few ideas for how health practitioners can get involved. So on to the good stuff. Just to ground us in what's going on in the current market, so nationally, air source heat pumps, which are the predominant form of heat pumps installed for space heating and air conditioning, those are on track to make up about 30% of the heating market by 2030. We're, I think, at about 25% now. It can vary a lot state by state. And notably, air source heat pump sales recently surpassed gas furnaces. So we have sort of hit a threshold where air source heat pump sales are greater than gas furnaces, which is an exciting milestone and has continued now for a couple of years. You might be wondering about that little dip in 2022-23 that affected the whole HVAC market, and we think is related to both inflation and post-pandemic supply chain issues. I would also note that another thing you can see from this slide is that central AC sales are the highest, so central air conditioning. So that's a huge opportunity. If we could convert all of those installations of central air conditioners to two-way high efficiency heat pumps. We will have, that is probably the most cost-effective intervention point for many households, especially those households that already have central air conditioning. You could go from one central air conditioning unit and a gas furnace to just one heat pump that could take care of both heating and cooling. So that's an important kind of leverage point for the market. So looking to federal funding, I'm sure you've all heard of Bill and Ira, the friendly uncles of federal funding, but the Inflation Reduction Act and the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law, these are really huge for the heat pump market. And I've highlighted on this slide just kind of three different ways they're jumpstarting the market. One is they're transforming the market in a longer term way. For some of us that were old enough to be around during the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, following the 2008 crash, that was more of a short-term stimulus. So it was a little bit more of a boom and bust kind of situation. The IRA has generally a 10-year horizon, so it should be able to drive more durable market change. There's unprecedented funding. So just, you know, one program, I'll talk about this more alone, is this Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund is three times EPA's entire annual budget. Also, notably, it's mostly carrots, few sticks. So there's a lot of funding. There's not a lot of new federal regulation. And then there's a sense of urgency. A lot of this funding is administered by states. There's kind of a scramble going on now where states are just applying for funds left and right and kind of scrambling to obligate funding so it can't be clawed back before the election. But all of this adds up to the building electrification market, the heat pump market, is going to look really different in 2030 than it looks today. Sorry, just adjusting my screen for a second. So this slide just gives a snapshot. I'm not expecting you all to read this. I'm not going to go through all of this, but just showing some of the various funding sources for the building sector in Bill and IRA. And it's significant altogether. Some of these funds can be used in different ways, but you know, altogether, there's probably more than $40 billion for buildings in these two pieces of legislation, some of which are really significant. So it's a lot of funding. It's truly unprecedented, and a lot of it can be used for heat pumps. I'm going to just give a spotlight on two of the most important sources of federal funding, two of the most important programs within IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act. The first is the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund. This is essentially, you might have heard of this as like the National Green Bank. It's actually kind of multiple banks, but this is essentially to mobilize capital for climate investments. The awards have just been announced for all three of these tranches, which are laid out here, the National Clean Investment Fund, the Clean Communities Investment Accelerator, and then Solar for All. And overall, it's anticipated that more than two-thirds of this funding and financing is going to go to projects in disadvantaged communities, and 50% is going to be used for building sector upgrades, which could be heat pumps, could be efficiency, you know, could be other types of upgrades in buildings, but a lot of it is likely to be electrification upgrades. So that's going to be really significant, and we're going to be really excited to see how that all plays out. And then the other really exciting program is the electrification rebates. I've actually got an image here from Wells organization Rewiring America, just sort of a nice little summary of the forthcoming incentives. These are going to be delivered through states, so they're not available yet, except in New York, where they are starting to be available, but they should be available soon. It's kind of state specific exactly how they're rolling out. But generally, there are up to $14,000 available per household. These are just for low and moderate income households, although it's a pretty generous definition of moderate income. So significant funding, and $8,000 for an HVAC heat pump. And that's on top of a up to $2,000 tax credit for heat pumps as well that is currently available. So significant funding, a lot of which is heavily weighted to disadvantaged communities. there's also, because of all of this investment and a lot of the federal work and work at the state level that's going on, there's also a real push in terms of new heat pump technologies. They're expanding access by making sure there are heat pump, high efficiency heat pump solutions for, like, you know, new and different configurations in homes and in buildings. So for example, on the left side is a window unit, like replacing a window air conditioner with a higher efficiency heat pump. That's something that could be really handy in an apartment building. There's also a lot of work. I saw we had a Q&A question about heat pumps in cold climates. There's been a lot of work on cold climate heat pumps, a lot of which has related to ductless heat pumps. But there's been a recent push on cold climate performance for ducted heat pumps, which can more directly replace homes that have ducted heat, like central AC and furnaces. So, and DOE has kind of an accelerator around that going on. So just lots of new development. So what's available now in the heat pump market is changing really rapidly, and there's going to be just way more heat pump options and price points available to be able to deal with kind of every different configuration in a building over the next five to 10 years or so. So really exciting changes in the market. I'm now going to shift gears to what's going on at the state level, because states are getting in the game as well on top of all of this federal investment. I'll start with a really exciting announcement from the US Climate Alliance. This is an alliance of governors that have committed to climate action. They're listed here. But last September, they announced a pledge to decarbonize buildings and quadruple heat pump installations by 2030. That's about 20 million heat pumps by 2030 over all of these states. So that's a really great high-level commitment kind of from the governors of these states. And then my organization, NESCOM, built on that with an MOU that we announced back in February, a Memorandum of Understanding, which was a multi-state agreement to accelerate the transition to zero-emission residential buildings. This was really designed to build on the Climate Alliance announcement and further lock in that momentum. So we have 9 states that signed on originally, and we actually have just heard that DC is signing on as well, haven't even had time to update our graphic. But just in terms of a sense of how that will impact the market, if you think back to my previous slide, we're at about 25% heat pumps in the HVAC market. So heat pumps make up about 25% of the market currently, and we're on track to get to maybe 30% by 2030. These states are committing to get to 65% by 2030 to really increase the pace of heat pump adoption. And they're currently working on an action plan to do that, to put in place policies and programs that can drive action at the state level. There are a lot of policy options that states have at their disposal to decarbonize buildings and again, reach that 65% of sales level. This graphic is from an upcoming policy brief that I'm hoping will be released next week that we've been working on with some partners at the Regulatory Assistance Project and Northeast Energy Efficiency Partnerships. But it reviews the range of policy options and tools that states can employ to drive heat pumps and decarbonize buildings in an equitable way. I'll just kind of observe that for those of you that follow what, you know, current policies for the building sector, there's basically energy efficiency programs, like you can get rebates for energy efficient products and upgrades, and there's building energy codes that states adopt and update. And those have been kind of the dominant policies. And now there's a flurry of new policies emerging that states are pursuing to accelerate their progress. I don't have time here today to walk through every one of these policies, but I'll just note that what we kind of talked about in this brief was how states could set the table for building decarbonization. And there are these 4 table legs where on the left side, you've got equity and workforce investments that are addressing historical inequities and ensuring that, the energy transition is just as and inclusive. So that includes things like making sure there are robust rebates or subsidies to help lower income households upgrade their homes and do electrification in a way they can afford. That also relates to equitable participation in developing all these policies and programs. Carbon reduction obligations are an innovative area that would include things like cap and invest that some states have adopted, but also an innovative policy called clean heat standards, where you could actually obligate people like gas utilities and fuel suppliers to reduce their carbon emissions or install clean heating systems. Codes and standards builds on building energy codes, but states are now looking at building performance standards, which some cities have adopted for their larger buildings, or equipment emission standards, which I'll talk about on the next slide. And then the last leg of the table is utility planning and regulation, which is really, there's a lot of pieces that need to be updated and adapted to support decarbonization in terms of how utilities are regulated. Everything from rate design to ensure that electrification is affordable from an operating cost perspective, to rejiggering the existing efficiency programs to be more climate forward and focused on greenhouse gas reduction and electrification, to gas transition planning and making sure that states aren't investing massive amounts of money into a gas system that we're going to need to wean ourselves off of and therefore are going to end up with a lot of stranded assets and costs that will be difficult to bear 20 or 30 years down the road. So there's a lot going on in all of these legs, and I've just given a kind of a taste of that. But if you're interested, we'll be happy to share this brief once it's published. I'm going to just quickly spotlight one particular policy that's very innovative, and it's a policy that NESCOM is working on quite a bit with our states, which is zero emission standards for building equipment, like space heaters and water heaters in particular. And this is a policy that states are looking at to both address climate pollution and air pollution. It could be designed around NOx or carbon dioxide, greenhouse gases. What this policy would do is say that once this is in place and the compliance dates have taken effect, if you have a polluting furnace and after the compliance date, you cannot replace it with another polluting equipment. You have to replace it with a zero emission option, such as a heat pump. It wouldn't mandate what that zero emission option is. But after a certain date, your new equipment that you're installing is going to have zero emissions. So that's a very innovative policy. It's something that states can do using their air regulatory authority. It doesn't have any impact on existing functional appliances. This would only kick in at the end of life when you would go to replace your furnace or your fossil fuel water heater. And it's something that is currently under development in California and Maryland. I'll just call out our friends in Maryland that on Monday just announced, Governor Wes Moore announced an executive order which takes a whole of government approach to addressing climate change. And it specifically directs the Maryland Department of the Environment to propose a zero emission heating equipment standard that will phase in zero emission standards for heating equipment to reduce carbon pollution and improve air quality inside homes and the ambient air. So this is a really innovative policy, and we're working directly with Maryland to develop that. In California, the Bay Area Air Quality Management District has enacted the nation's first zero emission standard. There have been longstanding low NOx standards for building equipment, but getting to zero is, Berkeley has taken the first step, and California is now taking that statewide. So that concludes my whirlwind tour of federal and state policy for building electrification. To close, I just wanted to emphasize it's really exciting to be here with a public health audience because we have seen in our work that the health impacts of building pollution are really significant, and that health practitioners and public health practitioners are very important partners and advocates for electrification. You can get involved by educating your colleagues, patients about the negative health impacts of fossil fuel combustion and the benefits of electrification. You can work with folks to address health disparities that disproportionately impact disadvantaged communities and people of color. And we have seen that health practitioners, doctors, nurses, communities that have high asthma rates have been incredibly important advocates for legislative and regulatory changes. So for that Bay Area policy that I mentioned, that the Air District recently adopted zero emission standards, we saw in the hearing a number of doctors testify. We saw eighth graders from a neighborhood in Oakland, very impacted by poor air quality, come in and advocate for this policy and describe themselves as a concerned sibling of a sister who has asthma. It was just incredibly powerful to hear from the public health community and to really band together for both climate and public health benefit. So I really appreciate the opportunity to talk about this with you all and hopefully have conveyed a sense of momentum for the work that we're doing to drive heat pump adoption. And that's it for me. With that, I will turn it back over to Jill, and I believe she will facilitate some Q&A.
Great. Thank you, Emily. We've had a really active conversation in both the Q&A and the chat. For folks who may not be aware, some of the questions that have come in have already been answered during the course of the webinar in writing in the Q&A. Some of those I'll pull out for us to discuss orally, but just want to direct folks to that. And I'll echo some of Emily's comments about presenting this information to a public health audience. Earlier in May, there was a public health law practitioners convening that many folks were at in New Orleans. And for the first time in my public health law career, there was a plenary focused on environmental health. And we know that there are efforts ongoing. There's been a model state indoor air act produced. And so there are, I think, growing efforts in the public health law, public health and public health law sector to really attend to these air quality impacts in terms of both the climate pollutants and the criteria air pollutants, the environmental pollutants. So really exciting, and exciting that it's happening at a time when there is momentum. I will choose one of the questions from the Q&A that I think cuts right to the heart of the matter that I'd hope to hear from all of the presenters on. And the question is, if the technology and the funding are currently available through the bilateral infrastructure law and the Inflation Reduction Act, what is preventing larger scale implementation? And I would add to that, or what would facilitate, in addition to those things, larger scale implementation. And I do hope that any of our presenters who would like to weigh in on that will do so, but I believe someone already answered in the chat, so maybe I'll start. Wael, if you would go ahead maybe and respond first.
Sure, yeah, and definitely. This is sort of the question, so would love Emily and Eric's thoughts as well. Maybe I'll focus on sort of like the consumer side, since that's a lot of what sort of Rewiring America's work is around. I think a lot of people just don't yet know that heat pumps are a thing. I'll sort of focus on heat pumps. I think a lot of this applies to sort of building electrification overall, but just in a lot of the research we do, folks either aren't aware about heat pumps or think that, it works in some places, but it's not right for my home. And a lot of times it's just a lack of awareness around that these sort of very powerful machines, which can both heat and cool your home, which can improve air quality, which can bring down carbon emissions, that they exist and that they are an option for their homes. I think a lot of that extends to the sort of installers and contractor networks in terms of, and so the work we're doing there is really trying to partner with on contractors and installers to improve education and resources so that rather than the default option being a new gas furnace or an oil furnace for a home, folks are exploring the potential for heat pumps, especially for climate motivated folks who sort of want to be some of the early adopters for this. I think something we didn't mention is that, in some states in the South, like South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, a large plurality of homes actually heat and cool with heat pumps already. So they are very popular in some parts of the country, and a lot of folks just don't know that they have them in their homes. They just know, I have one device. I switch the temperature on my wall and my house gets cooler when I need to, or it gets warmer when I need it to. And so that's something that we're focusing on, at least a lot, is sort of the consumer education piece of it.
Yeah, I could add to that a little bit. I would concur on all of those points. We definitely hear we have a lot of work to do with the contractors, a lot of misinformation, contractors saying that they don't work in cold climates. Heat pump technology is improving rapidly, especially cold climate performance. So we have a lot of work to train contractors and make sure everybody is up to speed about the latest and greatest in heat pump performance, and not kind of thinking about their grandfather's heat pump from the 70s that might not have worked very well. That's definitely a big issue. And then just on the cost side, as I think Eric's presentation showed, they are generally more expensive on an upfront basis. Sometimes a lot more expensive depending on the configuration. The most cost-effective scenario would be if you have a gas furnace and you have a central air conditioning and you want to replace both of those at once by going from two systems to one. It could probably be sort of comparable. If you don't have an air conditioner and you want one and you're installing a mini split, then but if you're just a one-to-one replacement, a lot of times the upfront cost could be very expensive. And that's why a lot of these new tax credits and rebates and incentives, federal, state ones, are going to be really, really helpful. And then finally, in a lot of states, there's still a lot of work to do to straighten out the operating costs. So once you've got it, for some customers, especially customers that currently use gas, it could cost them more, even though the equipment is much, much more efficient. And we have a lot of work to do with our utility commissions to straighten out rate structures and make sure that, cheap gas doesn't lock people into a more polluting option in the long term, and that rates are aligned with where we need to go from a climate and equity perspective, which is a big project.
Yeah, I agree with all that the other panelists answered with. I just wanted to add on, specifically about the IRA rebates. There's a lot of focus on the IRA rebate programs and the dollar amounts that Emily shared. But when you look at the scale of the problem, for there's say 100 million homes in the U.S. that could benefit, that basically could use a heat pump that don't already have one. Whether they're coming from a fossil heating system or from electric resistance heating. And that's a lot of homes, 100 million. If you look at the amount of homes that the IRA rebate programs could touch, it's maybe at most.
Did others lose Eric's audio?
Oh, yes.
Eric, we've lost your audio. I think he's lost ours too.
Oh no.
Oh no.
Sounds like it.
I think what Eric is saying is that the IRA rebates are just going to reach a very tiny percentage of the market, unfortunately. And we need to do a lot more. And that's also why some of the policies, like the zero emission standard policy that I highlighted, that would influence choice of installation when you're installing a new piece of equipment, could be very, very helpful because, you know, anyone that installs and, you know, their equipment dies and they install another piece of fossil fuel equipment, another gas furnace or another, you know, gas water heater, that's going to be in place for another 15 or 20 years, potentially continuing to pollute well into the future. So if we could catch those when they're being replaced and divert people towards the heat pump option, a zero emission option, that would be really impactful. Sorry to jump in, Eric, but we couldn't hear you.
Yeah, no, great rescue. Thanks, Emily.
Yes, thanks to all of our presenters. It takes a village. And I appreciate that point about the role of the contractors. It came up quite a bit in the comments, and it's something we've been looking at a bit in the network. I live in Minnesota myself, and I know Minnesota has an air source heat pump collaborative. That's a collaboration between our State Department of Commerce and a nonprofit called the Center for Energy and Environment that works on providing training and technical assistance, among other things, but works on providing training and technical assistance to contractors and installers. So that's one model. People may also be interested in looking at California. In California, the State Public Utilities Commission actually provides funding for renewable energy networks that, again, among other things, provides training and technical assistance, including assistance on code compliance to contractors and installers. So those are just a couple examples there. Let's see, what's next in our questions? I wanted to go right for the one that to me struck right to the heart of the matter. One of the conversations that we had in preparation for the webinar and that I think has come up in the questions has to do with a co-benefit, if you will, of heat pumps in terms of air filtration. And I wonder if someone could speak to that as an aspect of how heat pumps affect indoor air quality. Maybe you, Eric?
Yeah, one thing that people may not necessarily realize is that today's modern heat pumps that are variable speed, and that just means that they run—they kind of modulate the amount of heating or cooling that they output in order to keep the whole home comfortable without like large swings when, say, your thermostat kicks on or kicks off. One side benefit of these variable speed heat pumps is that they're continually filtering the air. If you have central duct system and you have a filter on that system, they can continue to filter the air throughout the household at a really low speed, but you get that continual filtration of air. And if you have a high a filter that can filter out a lot of small particles, then that can provide a lot of indoor air quality benefits just by virtue of kind of running at that low speed continuously. And related to that is also the benefit, you know, I think no matter where you live, there's the chance of having wildfire smoke, which means that if you are normally opening your windows to keep cool, you may not want to do that from a health perspective. And heat pumps or providing air conditioning in general to households that don't currently have access to air conditioning can be a really real benefit in being able to stay comfortable and stay safe while closing windows when there's wildfire smoke outside.
Right. Thank you, Eric. Anyone else want to weigh in, or shall I move on to the next question? One thing that came up a lot in the questions were kind of regional differences. So questions from Wisconsin about cold climate heat pumps, questions from New Mexico about, you know, sometimes colder winters or, you know, particular maybe at higher elevations. But also I think, you know, just in the last week or two with the launch of, you know, the onset of a number of heat waves in the Southwest kind of early in the season and the release, frankly, of a lot of extreme heat tools and including epidemiology tools. You know, questions about, are there regions in the country where it makes more sense or a heat pump might be more or less advantageous? How would our panelists parse that out?
I can take a quick stab at, I think, parts of this. I think Eric covered some of it in They're really sort of comprehensive analysis, heat pumps for all, which I don't know if Eric, you want to drop anywhere a link anywhere for folks. I think I can maybe at least address part of it on sort of cold climates in places like Wisconsin or New Mexico, where it gets very cold. You know, I think it's a reasonable concern for folks. Like, it's just new technology. It gets to, you know, -5 degrees here. Like, can I actually heat my home with a heat pump? And, you know, Emily touched on this. The technology for high efficiency cold climate heat pumps means that some of the best models work down to -20, -30 degrees Fahrenheit, which covers sort of the vast, vast majority of, you know, the coldest days in the continental US. Something I think is underappreciated or folks don't know is that one of the states doing the most to advance heat pumps is Maine, where it gets very cold, where they have to deal with very cold winters. But the state is doing a lot to sort of move homes that are, you know, spending hundreds or thousands of dollars, really thousands of dollars in the winter on delivered fuels to upgrade to ductless heat pumps that sort of work in their homes. And it's been such a success that they've actually increased their targets. So all this to say is that most, you know, high efficiency cold climate heat pumps will work in very cold environments. I think as Eric showed in their analysis, whether it's going to lead to lower cost savings is really dependent on a bunch of factors. But I think one of the biggest ones is how much you pay for, you know, your existing heating fuel, many times, you know, natural gas, I think most prominently, and how much you pay for electricity. Because in some states, the sort of spread between those costs means that heat pumps can be more expensive to operate. If you'd sort of like a sort of home specific answer, we've actually put together a tool using all of the Redstock data that Eric's team made on Rewiring America. And I'll drop a link for that in the chat. And you can put in a few pieces of information about your home and actually get some estimates on what the costs and benefits might be for homes like yours. So I'll drop that for folks if you're interested as well.
Yeah, one thing I was going to add is, really, I don't, you know, a heat pump can work at anywhere. Air source heat pumps, you know, they can work in all climates. In some cases, if a home has a really inefficient building enclosure, it doesn't have much insulation and is really leaky, then it might take a really big heat pump to meet that full load. And in those cases, then it probably makes sense to do insulation, add a bunch of insulation, do air sealing, and then the heat pump is going to be just right for that. Now, there may be some homes where like that's a huge project and can't take it on right now. And in those cases, homes that are currently heated with gas, there's also dual fuel or hybrid heat pumps that could make sense in some cases where in places where gas is still pretty cheap. And that can kind of be an interim solution where on the coldest days, it's using natural gas furnace, whether an existing one or a new one that's put in. And then during more mild days, it's using the heat pump. And then the heat pump doesn't have to be very large. It could be the same size as an existing air conditioner. And it's relatively lower cost to put in and the home doesn't necessarily need to do a lot of insulation and air sealing. But there would be a lot of other comfort and resilience benefits from doing the insulation and air sealing eventually anyway.
Great, thank you. All right, we've got time for a few more questions. A number of questions about different settings and contexts for heat pumps, including renters and those in affordable public housing. So what is the consideration for consumers that are renters? We have found that landlords aren't incentivized to put the cost upfront to make these upgrades, even with the attractive rebates. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I dropped a link and I'll do so again in the chat for folks. But this is definitely sort of a concern for folks because, you know, if you're a homeowner, you have, you know, sort of full control over whatever you're doing in your house as opposed to being a renter. And so we did put together some materials for our folks who are renters who are interested in, you know, sort of electrifying their household. Including some tips on how to talk to your how to talk to your landlord, and sort of like talking points or just ways that you can chat with them and sort of give them more information about what electrification means, and you know, why it could be beneficial for the household that you're in. You know, we've seen studies that electrification can raise a building's value, you know, which a landlord would obviously be, you know, probably in favor of. Many landlords are, you know, also climate or health motivated. So a lot of the benefits that we've talked about in this webinar could also be, you know, beneficial for landlords. And then the IRA does include some provisions for multifamily dwellings, and there are different grants and loans available. There's sort of specifics about the types of buildings that are allowed, but and you know, the tenants who live there, but there are some provisions to help with covering some of those upfront costs. So I'll drop the link in the chat, at least for sort of a resource that folks can refer to.
Great, thank you. There was also a question about whether and how heat pumps work in manufactured housing. Anyone care to comment on that?
Yeah, I can take that one. So the same heat pumps that work for other single family homes can work great in manufactured housing or mobile homes. Yeah, one thing to pay particular attention to is the duct system. In some manufactured homes that have central duct work, the ducts can be under the belly of the home, and they're kind of notorious for being pretty leaky. So if you're putting in a heat pump and reusing the existing duct work that's under the manufactured home, then you just want to pay particular care that the ducts are well sealed and well insulated, or that even you're insulating that space under the home, insulating the walls of that space under the home, so that you don't have a lot of duct losses. And if it's really bad, then maybe you would consider moving to a ductless system in those instances. But yeah, absolutely, the same technology can work for manufactured homes.
Thanks, Eric. And I believe the state of Maine has a pilot project working on installing heat pumps in manufactured and mobile homes. One other setting that there was a question about, and Emily, I wonder if this one might be for you, just since you mentioned advocacy by the, you know, health professionals, including public health professionals and healthcare providers. But someone asked, have any of the larger hospitals or health systems begun changing their heating cooling systems over to heat pumps or similar greener systems? It seems most large hospital buildings still have ugly smokestacks somewhere on their facility maps.
Yeah, and I think this was answered in the chat with some links to resources that people might want to check out. There are a number of healthcare industry focused initiatives to lead by example through the healthcare industry in various ways. It's definitely something people are looking at. I believe there is an all-electric hospital in California now, perhaps the first one. And I know the South Coast Air Quality Management District was looking at that. This is not the easiest market segment to electrify, I will say. Certainly if you were building a new hospital from scratch, you could figure out a good electrification solution. To transition it is certainly not impossible, but it's going to require some really careful analysis and engineering, in part because healthcare is also going to require a lot of high temperature water, and you know, is going to need really good performance of that type of water. And they're very large systems. They might have their own plants, and that's kind of the hardest. Like high temperature water heating in very large applications is like the hardest possible part of the market to electrify right now. That's not to say it's impossible. And I think in 5 years, we'll have a lot more solutions and examples there. But you know, that's one of the reasons why NESCOM's work, our multi-state agreement, started with the residential sector, because that's really where we have market-ready solutions. We know what we need to do. The market's ready. Not quite ready. The contractors aren't quite ready, but it's getting ready. The technology is mostly ready. you know, it kind of makes sense to start there as opposed to going directly to the hardest possible engineering scenario. But with that said, there are certainly exciting examples happening in hospitals, some of which are linked in the chat. I know we're almost out of time, but I was hoping that Eric or Wal could speak to the maintenance questions, because that's come up a bunch of times, like in the chat, that people are concerned that heat pumps might break more often, and that issue was raised by several people, and I was just hoping you could briefly touch on it.
Yeah, I guess I don't really see heat pumps as having any additional maintenance costs compared to air conditioners. You know, you typically still have a filter, whether it's in a ducted or central system. You have a filter that's going to need to be replaced. Same thing with a ductless system. There's a filter that needs to be, a lot of the ductless ones, you can just rinse them in underwater and then put it back in. So it's really no cost for maintenance there. and then, yeah, so I don't really see any difference. I've had my heat pump for almost 10 years now and have done zero maintenance on it.
All right, great personal testimonial. Yeah, and just to throw out something public health folks may be familiar with in the healthy eating context is sort of the vegetable RX or the farmer's market prescription. And I know Boston Medical Center has done a clean power prescription to help utilizing their own solar energy facilities and resources to provide breaks on energy bills for some of their patients. So that's an example folks might be interested in looking at. We are at time. I don't know if any of the presenters, if there were any other questions you answered in the Q&A that you wanted to highlight, or if we ought to, I'll just pause there. Any last words? Well, otherwise, thank you so much, Eric, Wal, Emily. It's been terrific. I hope this is just the beginning of the conversation with at least the network and our constituents and stakeholders about the transition to heat pumps and more broadly building electrification. I think I'll hand things over to Daniel for a couple of closing comments.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Thank you again for attending today's webinar. Just a reminder that you will be receiving a recording of the webinar as well as the slides in about a week. You'll get those emailed to you when they're uploaded on the network's website. And then once again, I just want to give everyone a big thank you, especially to the presenters and Jill for leading this really great session today. And I give you all a couple minutes back of your day, and hopefully you all have a great afternoon. Thank you all.